So let me start from the figures, actually, what we are getting from the cybercrime domain. You know, if I'm talking about the Uttar Pradesh only, then in last 16 months, we have got more than 50,000 cases, 50,000 cases, you know. So now you can imagine what is the magnitude and dimension of the cybercrime. And the nature of the cybercrime, if I talk about, then it ranging from compromising your mail ID to cloning your Facebook ID, then cryptocurrency fraud, then ransomware attack. Each and every kind of online crime is happening. If we're going for the banking sector or financial sector, each and every type of crime, you know, from ATM hacking to cloning your debit card to cloning your credit card, compromising your UPI, compromising your wallet, everything is happening. You know, cloning of checks. You can clone the checks. Then no crime which earlier used to happen in banking sector in physical mode, all those crimes are happening online right now. So this is the threat, you know. Recently, we are getting lots of cyber ransomware attack cases, which is too complicated and very sophisticated in nature. And this is a real nightmare for the police officer and live enforcement agency to investigate this. Because once we are under ransomware attack, they are demanding the money in Bitcoin and cryptocurrency. And if we're paying the money in Bitcoin and any cryptocurrency, it's almost impossible to track them. So backtracking the criminal now has become almost impossible, because they are using lots of latest technology and tools, which is posing a very tough times for the police officers, because they are using virtual numbers. They are not using the real numbers indeed. Always they are on the VOIP platform. So, and they know that tracking a VOIP related call is very difficult for the police, because it's always a international by nature. So in most of the cases, we get support. In most of the cases, we don't get logs from different TSPs, from different VOIP operators, then the application developers, unless and until we are getting logs from all different entity in the entire supply chain. And if we are not able to connect the dots, that we cannot crack the case. And this is the real challenge for the police. So if somebody has launched a ransomware attack, and if we have paid the money in Bitcoin, almost a dead story for the law enforcement agency. And then they after taking, you know, a ransom for giving you a decryption key, thereafter they blackmail you that they are going to publish your entire data in dark web or in the public domain. So again, they are demanding the money. So this vicious cycle, you know, you are paying the money for decryption, then you are paying the money so as not to get your data published in the public domain or on the dark web. This kind of highly technical cyber crime are definitely posing a tough time for the police officer or for corporate sector even. Because in most of the cases, we have seen that corporate sector are victim. Earlier, it used to be a single individual. They used to be victim of the ransomware attack. Now, they are targeting the corporate sector. And recently, I went to the news article and we have seen it. It's an analysis report from different research organizations that those corporate sector who have taken cyber insurance policy, you know, they are the targets. Means this gang, ransomware gang, you know, they have got the database of those corporate sector, those enterprises which have subscribed for the cyber insurance policy. They are attacking, and silently they are paying the money, because the corporate is not bearing the entire cost. The insurance company has to bear the cost. Now a second, third dimension has been added. Because it's a very easy target. You launch a ransomware attack on a corporate, because they have taken the policy, then insurer is responsible and insurer are giving the money. But ultimately, if you analyze it, then the public is ultimate, you know, loser, because then the price of the policy will be higher. And there are whole lots of things, you know. So in last few months, we have seen cases that few people are, I mean, they are fraudster. They are involved into fake mining of currency, you know. Fake mining, because they will show you the labs, they will show you the processor, high-end gadgets and all that, and you know, the whole infra, and they tell you that we are mining cryptocurrency by a different name. Sometimes they blackmail in the, they say that we are mining the Bitcoin, sometimes they say that Ripple, and a different kind of cryptocurrency. So fake mining of cryptocurrencies into the market, and the people who do not understand this technology, blockchain technology, and they are really blind in purchasing all this cryptocurrency, because you have seen the boom in last few months. You have seen the boom in prices of this cryptocurrency. The lesser technically literate people are falling victim. So we have seen the cases in which you have purchased some Bitcoin, and the next day or over a period of time of 15 days, 30 days, your wallet is wiped out. So there is nil balance in your wallet. Even if you have purchased Bitcoin, the wallet shows that nil balance. It means your wallet was compromised, or it means the fake cryptocurrency platform was fake. Maybe entire cryptocurrency exchange was fake, or somehow your wallet compromised. The problem is that in that case, you cannot go to the police, because you know, Bitcoin currency is still not a legal tender here. So what you are going to complain? And even if we are receiving the complaint, then how to investigate it? Because the ultimate beneficiary in this Bitcoin currency system is unknown, you know. You cannot investigate who is the ultimate beneficiary. I have paid you money through, for example, suppose I have purchasing some credit card, Bitcoin, through my credit card. Okay, now I have a wallet. I have to pay someone. Then through wallet, I'm paying to someone in Bitcoin, you know. If the police wants to investigate it, it is almost impossible who is the ultimate beneficiary. So always I say that invest in something which is tangible, you know. Like suppose I have created a Bitcoin exchange platform, I mean cryptocurrency exchange platform, and I keep the entire KYC, know your customer database, who is purchasing and who is selling. So if this kind of infrastructure we can develop, then of course I can say that you can invest in Bitcoin. In an entity which is not known by its nature, and it's not clear who is receiving and who is paying and who is selling, then I don't advise, because I have seen so many cases. I have seen so many people, they have lost huge money in this cryptocurrency trading. So this is the newest crime before the police. More often we are getting the cases related with that. Then, you know, then in last few months we have seen a rise in such cases in which deepfake technology has been used, because in the night you get a video call, and that video call is by a girl, and the moment you receive the call, she start taking off her clothes. She gets completely naked, and then in the same screen they capture your photo along with that naked girl, and then they start blackmailing. So I have seen lots of women in 1,000 cases, not 1, 2, 3, you know, thousands cases, and there is a whole gang of at least 100-500 people. They are operating from Mathura and Mewat area and Bharatpur area. and they're making easy money, you know. They don't have to do anything. Simply, they make friendship with you on LinkedIn, on Facebook, Instagram. They read your profile. Okay, they become your friend. And thereafter, one day you get a call. The moment you receive the call, this whole kind of thing happens and they start blackmailing. So what they say, that you pay the money immediately in these accounts. So you can imagine how much mental trauma they undergo, because I have seen a very respected family, you know, the very someone who is in a very respectable position in government and organizations, they come to my office and they almost literally, you know, they weep before me how to save my prestige and dignity. They say that they are going to share this picture with your family members, with your friends. We are going to publish it on YouTube and on other sites. So they're so much afraid. And they keep on paying money. They just go on paying money, and the criminals are such that once they have got the money again, they demand 50,000 more, then 50,000 more, then 50,000 more. So our strategy is to create an awareness campaign among the public so that let them know the latest modus operandi of criminal, how the criminals are taking money through scanning a QR code for payment. Because in most of the cases, if you scan the QR code, then you don't know that scanning of QR code is not to receive the money, but to pay the money. So, this kind of scanning of QR code, and then somehow through social engineering tricks, they are getting your OTP. And, you know, lots of tricks, you know, because once our digital mode payment has started, we do not know. There is least awareness among the public. If I am sharing my OTP, if I am sharing my debit card details, like debit card number and expiry and then CVV, then what will happen? Because it's a very least awareness. Even among the literate people, they don't know. They think that this call is a genuine call. This call is coming from my insurance company, from bank officers, from loanee company. Somebody is offering to give you the loan, cheap loan and all that. Somebody is giving you some a different kind of services. Since we are entirely dependent on digital technology for anything, and that's why the criminal, they have become more and more smarter, and they are using some social engineering tricks. They're very smart in talking. So they somehow befool you into accepting their offer. And then ultimately you fall victim, and then your money goes out, you know. So now, if we're talking about the social media platform, you can see there are different kinds of crime happening. Some are making friendship, and then by somehow they are cheating you. There are so many dating sites, fake dating sites, fake website, you know. Somebody is promising goods at 70%, 80% discount, Apple phone and all that. And then ultimately you fall victim because phishing attack, you know, phishing pages and the phishing mail and all that. So now the latest tools and technology into the hands of criminal or, getting, you know, more and more. They're getting more and more technically smart. But unfortunate part of that is the we police, we enforcement agency. Even I'm talking about the corporate sector or the judiciary or the prosecutors, they are not updating themselves technically. They are not updating because then there are a whole lot of things like you need to understand the intellectual property law, then Information Technology Act, then you have to learn how to search and seize the entire digital evidences. There is a lot of cyber forensic involved. Cyber forensic in itself, it's a very complicated science domain. Unless and until you give full time, you do some full time course of 3-4 months, you cannot understand the cyber forensic. That's why the technical knowledge, technical expertise becomes the major lacuna, is shortcoming in the entire investigation framework. because we do not understand technology, so don't initiate anything. When we arrive on the crime scene, they don't know how to get the data. There are a whole lot of entities are involved. If you need the information from the information technology, like TSP, telephone operators, internet service provider, then we are not getting the data because the server are located overseas. There are lots of legal issues. Sometimes we have to get the data through mutual legal assistance treaty. Then we have to go to the court to get the data rogatory and all that. So it's almost a different scientific domain, which is beyond the understanding of the police, who are basically recruited for doing the physical work, you know, traffic, VIP protection, and physical crime, not to deal with the technical crime. We are trying to upgrade their knowledge, reskill them. But again, this needs a different mindset, you know, because you have to study a lot. It's a scientific domain. You need to understand the basic tools and technology. You need to understand the hardware, software. Then the forensic in itself is a different domain. So these are the challenges. We are trying to create such kind of expertise in police. We are training our prosecutors, even judiciary, but still we are lagging far behind. And the criminals, they are updating themselves on daily basis. They are really smarter, and they are posing bigger challenge. I'm sorry, I have to move for some important duty, so I cannot. Sorry for this. Okay, thank you.